We're going to go and get started this morning. We have with us today Nathaniel Ferguson. Nathaniel works in Pacific Islands Bible College. We support him in that work. We also supported his dad, Stacy, and also Kathy in their work over there as well. And so you'll notice some similarities, obviously, because they both work in Pacific Islands Bible College. Lisa and I have helped with them on some trips. Chuck and Jody have been on a trip with us as well. And so I look forward to hearing that. We're glad he's here with us. And we're going to have a word of prayer, and then we're going to turn over to Nathaniel and let him give that report. He's also going to bring a morning lesson this morning as well during worship hour. Let's pray together. Our Father in heaven, we thank you for this day you have given us. We thank you for the chance we have to come together in this place of comfort, to be able to hear and report the work that's being done, and also, Father, to be able to prepare our minds to worship you later this morning. We pray, Father, as we gather here this morning, that we remember those who cannot be here due to health. We pray, Father, they can restore to a good portion of health and be able to join us again. We pray, Father, for those who are not here out of choice, but that we pray they may have a change of heart and have a restored zeal to come back and be with us again. Pray to be with us this day, that everything is done in such a way that brings honor and glory to your name. For it's in Christ's name we pray. Amen. Amen.
Good morning, everyone. It is great to be with you today. Thankful to Russ and Lisa for picking me up from the airport yesterday and letting me stay with them last night. I'm thankful for good Christian family all over the world. And that includes you here and the congregation of Uluga. I was told to send my greetings from my parents and tell you that they are thinking of you, that they love you and appreciate you and all the work that you are doing. And I am thankful to you as well for your support in our work in the Pacific. And I wanted to take the time this fall to come be with you and to worship with you and also to talk to you about the work that you've been a part of in the Pacific Islands with the Pacific Islands Bible College. This is my second year working with the PIBC. I started in January of 2021, and I am on my first reporting trip this year as well. So this is my first time going around to all my supporting congregations giving updates. So a few things that I try to do when I am giving a presentation in different places is I try to remind everybody about the style of mission work that we do. You've been supporting the work. You've been a part of the work. So some of this you already know, you already understand. And these are just things I try to remind people to help remind them of this work when there are so many works that congregations support. Sometimes it gets a little foggy. Who's who and what's what. But with the Pacific Islands Bible College, we follow the style of mission work that Paul the Apostle did in the book of Acts. In Acts chapter 14, verse 21 through 22, you read of that kind of mission work being done. It says, "And when they had preached the gospel to that city and made many disciples, they returned to Lystra, Iconium, and Antioch, strengthening the souls of the disciples, exhorting them to continue in the faith." So the style of mission work that we perform is we go into a location, we evangelize, we try to help establish the Lord's church in an area, and then once we have helped establish a church and evangelize, we will move on to another location and work, but we continue to come back to the places that have been established, to the congregations throughout the Pacific that would like us to come back, and we try to teach them with the PIBC Bible classes as a form of equipping them, training them, teaching them more in God's Word, and edifying them, continuing to encourage them and help them to grow. Remember, in the book of Acts, as well as throughout the New Testament, that's what Paul sought to do. He would go from place to place, establishing the church, then coming back in his missionary journeys, encouraging them, and establishing elderships where it was a possibility. And so that's what Brother Robert Martin, our director, saw was a crucial and effective way to reach all the different areas of the Pacific. And right now, we go into 13 different countries out of the 22 countries in the Pacific. There are 10,000 populated islands, 6 million people across the Pacific, and we go throughout the entire Pacific Ocean, north, south, east, west. And we have about 2,000 students currently enrolled in the PIBC, and we go to 24 different locations in the Pacific, as indicated by those red circles. And we hope to continue to grow that number. With me and my family now joining the team, we're hoping to divide up more and be able to reach more of these places, because these Pacific island nations are not one island nations, but they're made up of chains of islands, and many of those are populated. So we want to reach to every location where there are people, where there are souls who need to hear the gospel. This is just a collection of pictures that I put together to show you some of the faces and the places that you've been able to reach with your work in the Pacific. Places like Palau and Fiji and Vanuatu and Tarawa and Saipan. Those are all places and congregations of the Lord's church that are located in those nations that you've been able to work with, that you've been able to help to grow and establish. In fact, the Pacific Islands Bible College has been connected with the establishment of around 70 different congregations in 20 different countries. Now, we don't want that to be the end of what we've done. We want a congregation of Lord's church in every place that there are people. But we are thankful for that opportunity and these people who have obeyed the gospel and are working in the Lord's kingdom in their local areas, and that we are blessed to be able to work with continuously through the PIBC. One other thing that we try to remind people about the PIBC is we're not a preacher training school. We're not a college campus. We take the classes and the courses and the teaching to the local congregations, invited by the members to come and give them this information at no cost to them, to help teach them and train them and equip them. And with this model that we have of a Bible college and the courses that we offer those to anyone who wants to come and study God's Word. This is a picture of our director, Brother Robert Martin. Someone was just talking about that flat top haircut that he has had for probably 40 years now. You can see in the picture, he's still wearing that haircut. He's giving a certificate, a diploma of completion to a lady in Saipan who's completed the required number of courses. We designed the PIBC to be a way of encouraging them to continue to study God's Word, to take the test as a way to help train them in their memory and their knowledge of God's Word, and give them something to strive for, to obtain as a certificate, a diploma, recognition for the hard work that they've done. So we're thankful to offer that to anyone. This is a picture of myself and my family. My name is Nathaniel Ferguson. My wife's name is Rachel, and we have two children. The boy, my son, he's the oldest. His name is Atticus, and our daughter is named Zoe. And I'm so thankful for my family to be with me and also to be a part of the work that I am doing in the Pacific. And one thing about my family is my children are young, but my son is already school-aged, and my daughter will start kindergarten next year. And with the work that I'm doing in the Pacific and all the traveling around that we do, my family and I still maintain our residence in the United States, in Atlanta, Georgia, where our overseeing congregation is. And I fly out on 4 or 5 trips a year to the locations in the Pacific to work. And sometimes I'm by myself, and then when my children are not in school and they're able to come, my whole family will come with me. And so I'm thankful for them to be able to come. I'm thankful to have them participating in that work, but I'll talk more about that later. But I am so thankful for them and their love and their work and support in the mission field. When I am not in the islands, though, I am working to raise my support. I have not completely met my budget, my goals for financial support for the work in the Pacific. I've been very blessed by the Lord. Sometimes it takes people many years to get to where they need to fully fund the work that they're doing. But I have been blessed by the Lord over the past year and a half to be able to go to different places. This is a booth that I set up last year, the year before, at the Memphis School of Preaching in Memphis, Tennessee, at their lectureship, and telling people about the work that we're doing, letting people know about the PIBC, talking to preachers and elders about possible teaching opportunities that they could have and trips they could take with us to the Pacific, but also raising that support, trying to make those contacts to finish the support and gain what we need to do the work. And when I'm not busy giving my reports or trying to gain the more supporters that I need, another thing that we do when we are in the States is we have a Bible college office, and this is the place where we print all of our materials. We record on video most of our lessons, and we mail those things out throughout the Pacific to the Christians, to the congregations for them to use. Even if we're not in their location at that time, they can still take the PIBC classes or the Bible study lessons that we have through the mail. So we do all that there in the office. We have a sister in Christ from our overseeing congregation who comes and works with us. There's a lot to be said about the role and the keeping track of all the grades and who's graduated and all those things that are on the back end of being part of a school. But there is a lot of work that has to be done in that capacity. And when we're in the United States, they're trying to do some of that work. We don't charge them for any of our textbooks or tracks or recorded material. So that's all at our expense. So we try to do our very best to give them the best quality we can with what we have. Another question that I've been asked a lot this year has to do with the pandemic and the lockdown and the countries across the world and how they've responded to the coronavirus. And one thing that I've been thankful to God for is the fact that the pandemic has not stopped the work of the Lord's church. One thing that I am thankful to Brother Robert Martin for is his foresight and understanding of the need to make sure that congregations of the Lord's church are self-sustaining. They are autonomous. So that even when the American missionaries are not there in that location, the church is still growing, it's still functioning, they're still working. And so we've been very blessed with the congregations that we are connected with, that they've continued to work even when we've not been able to reach them. They've continued to grow, they've continued to meet. Even if it wasn't necessarily something that everyone was doing, they were still going and trying to do what God has commanded them to do in their locations. But that being said, the restrictions on us to travel haven't been very bad at all either. This picture is a picture of a bracelet I got at the airport with United Airlines flying to Saipan. And what we simply had to do was fill out a form online. We had to tell them whether we were vaccinated. We had to get a test before we left, but we fill all that out online. And then when we arrive at the airport, we go up to the airlines and they give us this bracelet, and we don't have to do anything else. We got on the plane, we arrived at our location, no more testing, nothing else had to be done, and we were able to get to work. And that has slowly morphed into even more streamlined ways of getting in. Some places have no restrictions like this anymore. Some places we were going to back at the end of last year, they were still wanting us to come into the country and self-quarantine for a few days, but even that has been lifted already. And we don't have to spend time in our hotel room 2 or 3 days waiting to be released. Now we're able to just go in and get to work. A lot of them do require vaccination to enter the country, and some of the countries still require masks. But other than that, we're still able to go. We're still able to teach. We're still able to do that work. So we're thankful to the Lord for that. Romans chapter 16 and verse 16. This is a passage we kind of snicker at in the United States, where it says, "Greet one another with a holy kiss. The churches of Christ greet you." And we laugh at that because customarily that's not something you would do to your brothers and sisters in Christ. You wouldn't plant a kiss on them. But the concept, the idea of showing respect and love and care to your brothers and sisters in Christ is something we understand and we know. It's a command of the Lord to show that love and care toward each other. And I'm here to tell you that the brothers and sisters in Christ in the Pacific send their love to you. They are so thankful to you for your encouragement, for your work, for your ability to send us to teach. And every place that I've been in the past year and a half has told me to let you know how thankful they are for your work in the Lord's church and for your efforts in the Pacific. So they greet you and they show their love and share their great respect for you from the people, from the brothers and sisters in Christ, your fellow Christians in Saipan. They send their love and their thanks. From your brothers and sisters in Christ in Palau, they send their love and their thanks. From your brothers and sisters in Christ in Lombasa, Fiji, they send their love and their thanks. From your brothers and sisters in Christ in Buda, Fiji, they send their love and their thanks. From your brothers and sisters in Christ in Vatandamu, Fiji, they send their love and their thanks. And those are just some of the ones I went to this year, not only to include the ones that Brother Stacy and Brother Robert went to this year, all sending their thanks to you for your work in the Pacific. Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 6 through 7 discusses the idea under the law of Moses of training up the children to know the law of God, teaching it to them when you lay down, when you rise up, writing it on your doorposts. It talks about in this passage. And we understand in the New Testament that same principle of teaching our children, training them up in the Word of God. I used to do youth work at the congregation I worked at before I came to the PIBC. And there are lots of ways in the United States that we have invented to train children, to teach them. We have Bible classes that we have on Sunday, on Wednesday. We have youth devotionals that we do, especially in the South. We have youth devotionals with all the congregations in the county or in the area. We have the Lads to Leaders program that's very large among the Churches of Christ in the United States. So many different things that you can do to teach your children God's Word. Not to mention what you should be doing at home, your own personal Bible study with your children, teaching them how to live godly lives. But in all of those possible ways that you can train your children, and after my experience and work in that ministry, I can firmly assert that one of the best ways you can train your children in their knowledge and love of God is get them active in the work of God. That is one of the greatest things that you can do to train your children up. Get them active in God's kingdom. And I'm so thankful for the great blessing of having my family working with me in this ministry. I'm so thankful that by your help, Rachel, my wife, can come with me on these trips and teach the women and teach the children and work with me, handing out those tracts, being with me on those trips, on those journeys in my work in God's kingdom. I'm so thankful to you that I'm able to bring my children and show them what it's like to do the Lord's work in the Pacific. And this past year, in fact, my wife and my children, this year, in fact, my wife and my children were able to join me for 6 weeks in the country of Fiji, where we went to 3 different locations and taught the Bible classes. We evangelized. We had Bible studies. We had classes for the children in those villages, and they were there with me every moment of that work. And I'm so thankful to them for coming, for their eagerness to come, and also for the blessing to be able to have them there in the first place. This is, in fact, my children's first time out of the country. It was this year. Their first trip out of the United States was to the country of Fiji. In fact, we were there during the spring and the beginning of summer, and my son celebrated his birthday while we were in Lombasa, Fiji. He turned 5 years old. Now, of course, because of weight restrictions and things on airplanes, we couldn't bring him a bunch of presents or anything, but we were able to find a bakery down in the village that made cakes, and we bought him a cake, and we had a small celebration. But if you can't tell by that big grin on his face, he was just excited to have his birthday in Fiji. He thought that was amazing. And you know what? I can't say that I've had a birthday in a foreign country. Maybe some of you might be able to say that. But I can. That's a rare treat. At 5 years old, being able to say, I celebrated my birthday in Fiji was a great blessing. And not only that, with it blessing me and encouraging me to do my work, to have my family there, having my family with me was an encouragement to the Christians in the Pacific. I can't tell you how big of a difference my children being in Fiji with me made to the brothers and sisters in Christ there. This is a sister of the Batandanu congregation in Fiji. Her name's Sister Lo. She loved talking to Zoe, spending time with Zoe, and getting to know her. The other women loved Zoe, loved spending time with her. And the men loved playing with Atticus and spending time together. They just enjoyed playing with the children, talking to the children before and after classes, after worship, whenever we were together. They just enjoyed that time, and my children did as well. It was a great time of encouragement and bonding and fellowship, and I think my children did something that I couldn't do just by their presence. I think children are a great encouragement in the Lord's church, and not only to the adults, but to the children as well. All the children were excited to see some other Christian children from America there in their country with them in worship and in Bible class. And they would always play together before and after worship and spend time with my children. It didn't matter that they couldn't necessarily all speak the same language, but they knew how to communicate. They knew how to play. And so they enjoyed that time together. This is a picture of my son Atticus coloring with some of the children there in the congregation at Buda, Fiji. And it wasn't until I made this presentation and presented it that I realized every single one of those Fijians around my son is a little girl. I don't know if I need to be worried about that, concerned, but I didn't notice that till after I'd given the presentation, that he was completely surrounded by the females there in the congregation. Colossians chapter 1, verse 28, though, is the summation of our goal with the PIBC. Here we preach, warning every man, teaching every man in all wisdom, that we may present every man perfect in Christ Jesus. That's the goal of the PIBC. We want to help equip the Christians to do what they need to do to be faithful to God, put Him first in their life, and make it to heaven. And so when we go, one of our focuses is on teaching those PIBC courses. There are a lot of things that we do, but that is the number one focus. And then we have other things that we do in addition to it. But we go and we teach, like Brother Robert Martin in this photograph is in Saipan. We were over there at the end of 2021, I believe, and he was there with me, and I was teaching a class, and he wanted to have a men's leadership workshop one weekend before we started the PIBC classes, because when we got there, he saw the need for the men to be encouraged. They're all there by themselves. They're trying to lead the church on their own, and that can be difficult. So he wanted to spend a weekend just with the men of the church, encouraging them, teaching them. And he had a book that he gave them that wasn't necessarily a PIBC course, but it was something that we were trying to do to help teach them and help encourage them in their work in the church. And my father as well was with me this past year in Palau teaching, and he was teaching a course on the how of soul winning. Now, when we go to a place, and you probably already know this, but when we go to a place, we try to teach at least 2 PIBC courses at every place we go. And so when we were in Palau, my father was teaching one and I was teaching the other. And he taught one on the how of soul winning. And that is a course designed to show someone, a Christian, how to have a personal Bible study with someone else. And it's a practical course that goes over questions to ask, how to start a Bible study. But a key part of it is he actually goes through the personal Bible studies that he would teach to someone. And he does it to the class, teaches it to the class as if they're not Christians. And so not only are they getting practical advice, but they're getting an example of what to teach, how to teach it, and material that they can take with them and go and teach someone else. And that has a twofold benefit, and I'll talk about that in a moment. Not only does it encourage the Christians and help give them proper training to be evangelists, but it also helps when we're evangelizing. And I'll point out an example of that in a few moments. For myself, I'm also there teaching the classes, and we try to be flexible with our time when we're over there, but most often, what we end up doing is teaching Monday through Friday for 2 hours in the evening or 2 hours in the morning. And we'll have maybe a 5 or 10 minute break between each hour, but we'll teach 2 hours every night for about 2 weeks if we have the time in that location. And we will give them the test at the end of the course, but we will spend that time every evening teaching and learning those courses. And here is a picture of myself. I am in Bandamu, Fiji, teaching a course on Joshua through Esther. Now, can anyone tell me how many books are between Joshua and Esther? 12. And in this specific location, this was the last place we were going in Fiji, so we had already been there for about 4.5 weeks. And our time in this location was a little bit shorter. I had about 7 days to teach the course. And then on the 8th day was when I gave the test. But in 7 days, I had to cover 12 books of the Bible. And they sat there for 2 hours every night on that concrete slab, cross-legged, listening closely, asking excellent questions. And no one at this specific location failed that test. But they were all interested, wanting to study God's Word. And what we try to do when we teach books of the Bible is we try to give them an outline of the book, but we also try to give them practical lessons that they can take and apply at that moment to their lives. And so we are working with them, spending all that time in study, and they are just wonderful, wonderful students who are very intelligent and learn so much in such a little time. And while we're teaching those classes, when we have our families with us, the ladies are oftentimes teaching children's classes. And this is a picture of my mother, Kathy, in the blue shirt, my wife, Rachel, in the white shirt, teaching some of the children in Mombasa. This is my mother teaching one of her books that she has written for children specifically that you can actually get. You just call her and she can get you a copy of her book, but it's designed to teach children, and she designed it with the island children in mind, so it's very simple, it's very clear, very easy to understand. But here she's teaching a class to the children in Buda, Fiji, while we are with the adults in another room or another building in the village teaching the PIBC courses. 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 2. Preach the word, the instant, in season, out of season, reprove, rebuke, exhort, with all longsuffering and doctrine. That is one of the most important things that we try to do when we are in the Pacific. We might be teaching the PIBC courses 2 hours every night, but when we're not doing that, we are trying to preach the word. We are trying to evangelize. And that comes in a myriad of different ways. This is actually a picture of us in Saipan back in 2021, where we went to a market day. It was one Saturday they had in Saipan where people came out and set up booths to sell their food or their clothes or whatever products they had. And we thought it would be a good idea to hand out DVDs and tracts on that Saturday to people who came for that market day. One thing that we tried to do, though, was we tried to talk to the brethren about purchasing us a booth because you actually had to rent a spot. But when we got there, we found out that they hadn't taken care of that so that we could pay for a booth, but one of the sisters in Christ who had already paid for her booth, because she sells clothes, if you can see them in the top right-hand corner. She had already paid for a booth. She just told the people there at the congregation, she said, Well, you don't make them buy a booth. I'll let them have my booth on this Saturday. So she took all of her stuff and she moved it all to the side to the back of this spot that she had set up. And she gave us the very front and center location of her booth so that we could hand out tracts and talk to people about God's work. Her name is Sister Corn. And she was so generous in that way because we know that it costs a lot to rent that location, that spot, that she needs that income from the selling of her clothes to make a living. But she took that hit. She put her things to the side just so that we could have time to share the gospel. Luke chapter 14, verse 23 talks about going into the highways and the hedges and compelling them to come in. When we go into the Pacific, we door knock a lot of times, and that's not necessarily knocking on a door, but that's going up to someone's house and saying, "Hey, are you there?" And see if someone calls back, and we'll talk to someone, we'll hand out tracts, we'll try to set up a personal Bible study. In one location in Palau, one of the members there, Brother Benjamin, he's an elderly man. He has a bad back and bad knees. He was really wanting, zealous, to go out and hand out tracts. So he actually went with us one day while we were out handing out tracts. And we had to take it slow. We had to sit down when it started raining because he can't walk up and down hills very well. But he was just so happy to be out there sharing the gospel with people in the area around the church in Palau. So we are thankful for opportunities like that because those opportunities lead to Bible studies. And this is a picture of my father in Palau having Bible study with a lady whose husband was a member of the church, but she had not yet obeyed the gospel. And we had several days that we were able to stay with her for an hour or two at each time and be able to share with her the gospel. One of the members had, one of the couples that were members of the church there had a daughter who was about 13 years old. She had some questions about baptism, and they invited us to their home to study with her and answer her questions to see if she wanted to be baptized. And we were thankful for time set aside to do that as well. And this is actually a photograph of us in Saipan. And if you look at the back of the table, there's a man and a woman. Their names are Chris and Yvonne. They are not members of the Lord's Church. But they came in to our Bible class, our PIBC class, one night when they heard about it because they were wanting to study the Bible. And they came in, and it just so happened to be my father teaching the How of Soul. And they came into the class, and they heard the teaching of the gospel. They were unknowingly having a personal Bible study in this class. And through that interaction and through that study, they became very interested in what the gospel said about the work that we were doing. And so they invited us to their house on a few occasions. We spent a few hours studying with them, answering their questions. And in fact, after one of those times that we met, they gave us lunch while we were there studying with them. And they were so thankful. They said, It's unusual. We have never found someone that will just tell us what the Bible says. A lot of times when we talk to people, ask questions, they want to tell us what their preacher says or what their creed says, but you open the Bible and you just tell us what the Bible says. And that's what struck them from the classes and from our personal Bible studies. And we were thankful for that time. And they continued to come to the classes the entire time we were there. And the man in the white shirt, that's the preacher at the church there in Saipan. His name is Boyette. He is continuing to study with them and work with them in hopes that they will obey the gospel. Acts chapter 8, verse 4. Therefore, those who were scattered went everywhere preaching the word. When we go into the Pacific, we come in contact with many different opportunities that you would not believe that come across our path, doors that open, that if we were not there at that specific time, who knows if anyone would have been able to reach that person or help that person who needed to hear the truth. And in fact, when we were in Fiji this last time in the summer, in the spring, we had such an opportunity. In this photograph, we are on a boat going across the open ocean. Now, I've been out in the open ocean in Florida, out toward the Keys. But this is the first time I've ever been out in the middle of the Pacific Ocean on a little motorboat. And that was a different experience. But the reason why I was on that boat on this trip is the man in the black hat, his name is Sukusi, he's a member of the church in Rondamu. He knew of a brother in Christ who had previously worshiped with him at that congregation, who had fallen away from the Lord. He was married, he has children, but he left his family, his wife, and went to another island off the coast of the one we were staying on, and was living with a woman that he was not supposed to be with. And Brother Sukusa knew where he was staying, and he just asked us one day, would you be willing to go talk to him? And we said, sure. So we took about a day. It took about a day to travel around to reach this other island where this unfaithful brother was staying. But Brother Sukusa and another brother in Christ went with us and showed us the way. And we were able to pay a ferryman to take us across the ocean to this island. And we were able to find that brother in Christ who had turned away from his family and from the Lord. And we visited with him for about 5 minutes. My father was with me at this time. We both talked to him. But then Brother Sukusa and the other brother in Christ began to speak to this man after us in their native language, in Fijian. And they talked for about another 5 minutes in Fijian. And then that brother who was living unfaithfully, he just walked away and started going down the road. And we turned to Brother Sukusa and we said, well, what happened? We couldn't understand what y'all were saying. What was going on? What did he say with our encouragement? They said, well, we talked to him. We told him that we loved him, that we cared about him. We wanted him to do what's right. And he wasn't in the right place. They said, and he agreed. So he's actually going right now to get his stuff. He's going to tell that woman he's with that he's leaving. He's getting back on the boat with us today, and he's going to come stay with us until he can make it right with his family. And that's exactly what he did. He got back on the boat with us, came back, stayed in the village where he used to attend with these brethren, stayed in the church house, actually, and made a public confession of repentance that following Sunday. This was on a Saturday that we went, and he made it the next day. And then every day after that, he was with us in personal Bible studies. He was studying with us, asking his own questions. And he was also at every single one of the PIBC classes in the evening. And he's working to make things right with his wife. And it just so happened that we were there at that time, and Brother Sukusa thought it might be a good opportunity. Things that you would never imagine you would go and do, because we didn't know how this was going to turn out. We were going to another location away from where we were staying. We were not with the congregation. It was just us and two other brothers in Christ that came with us. You know, sometimes in the Pacific, if you get somebody mad, you can get a whole village mad at you. And we weren't sure what we were going to step into with this man and what he might say or what he might try to do. And we were kind of alone. Other than the brothers with us. But the Lord blessed us. The Lord opened doors for us. And we are very, very thankful to him for that opportunity. Speaking of those Bible studies that we had with this man, this is a picture of us at the church house in Bondamu every day for probably about 3 hours every day in the morning. We were having personal Bible studies in the church house. The man in the polka dot white shirt there sitting beside me. His name is Pio. He was there every day studying with us. The man sitting in the chair was not a member of the church, and we were studying with him and trying to teach him the gospel. But there's also some other men that aren't in the photograph that were there as well asking questions. Some of them were members of the church. Some of them were not, but they were invited to study. So some days we would be teaching personal Bible studies. Other days we would be answering Bible questions. But it was a great time of studying and working and communicating and fellowshipping together. And while we were in the church house doing that, the ladies invited my wife and my mother to another house in the village where the Christian ladies were staying. And they had their own Bible study for about 3 hours every day, in addition to the Bible classes that we were having, answering questions, studying together, fellowshipping, and that was just a great time of studying God's word. And you know what? My children were there every step of the way. They didn't miss a beat. This is actually a photograph of us back in Mombasa Beach, handing out tracts in a hot, hot summer. But they didn't miss a beat. In fact, they kind of got competitive about who was going to hand out the most tracts. And we had to start telling them to take turns because my son would run up to somebody and hand a tract, and my daughter would run up behind him and hand that person the same tract. So we had to start taking turns, but they thoroughly enjoyed it. And the people thoroughly enjoyed meeting the children. This is my son, Agnes, giving a tract to a lady who's sitting outside of her home. This is my daughter, Zoe, handing out a tract to a lady outside of her home. They all just smiled big, opened up, and were so happy to meet the children. They definitely responded more kindly to my children than they ever did to me when I came up to hand out tracts. I'm not going to take that personally because I do think they're rather adorable, but I'm thankful to my children for their zeal and their energy and hard work in serving God. So all those blessings that we were able to do just with the evangelism side of our work in the Pacific. But I also want to draw your attention to Mark chapter 16, verse 15 and 16. And this is where we will close out our Bible class hour with this passage and one more. But in Mark chapter 16, verse 15 and 16, we are familiar with this. Great Commission is what we call it. Where Jesus says to his disciples, go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. He who believes and is baptized will be saved, but he who does not believe will be condemned. One of the things that I see in the Pacific, here in the United States, is the power of discouragement in the local church. And what I mean by that is in every place that I go, you can see how discouraged members of the church can get when things aren't going well or things aren't going the way they think they should. The pandemic especially has made that very apparent. Many churches have lost members. Many churches aren't doing as well as they want to. They maybe have gotten some of their members back, but they're still not where they were before. And it's a time because of all this where a lot of people are feeling discouraged because of attendance, or perhaps because they haven't had enough baptisms this year that they would like, or maybe they've been trying to study with somebody and they have rejected the gospel message. They've tried to talk to their coworkers, but they don't want to study the Bible. To their family, they don't want to study the Bible. To their friends, they don't want to study the Bible. And all of these things together just can weigh a church down and discourage the church when it comes to evangelism in the ministry. And one of the things that I noticed with all of those discouragements is a lot of times it's because we get caught up in the numbers. We get caught up in what we think things should be like and what they actually are like. And we think that we're failures because of that. We think that we are not doing the Lord's work or that God is displeased with us because of how things are going. But I want you to notice what Mark 16, 15, and 16 actually says. I want you to make a distinction between verse 15 and verse 16. Verse 15 is a command to you as Christians. Go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. Your responsibility as a church is to give people the opportunity to hear the gospel of Jesus Christ. That's your responsibility. To share with them the good news. Verse 16 is the person with whom you are trying to teach. That's their responsibility. He, the individual that you have presented the gospel to, has a choice to believe or to not believe, to obey and be baptized or not to obey and be baptized. And their spiritual life, their salvation is dependent on their choice, but not yours. God said, go and teach. When you fulfill that part of your responsibility, then God will be pleased with you. When you've presented people with the opportunity to hear the truth, God will take that into your account and will acknowledge the work that you're doing. Even if they reject you, even if they are not baptized, you are still fulfilling your responsibility to the Lord. So even when things seem like they're not going as well as you think they should be, even when doors seem to be shutting in your face, remember your responsibility isn't to dunk them in the water. Your responsibility isn't to force them to believe. That goes against the idea of belief to begin with. Your responsibility is simply to give them the opportunity to know God's will for them. If you do that, the Lord will bless you. Go to Matthew chapter 9 and let's look at verses 36 and 37. That's a little small. Let me see if I can make this bigger. Put this on the screen for you. Yes, is that a little bit more readable? Let's get that. Okay. Verse 36 and 37. This is Jesus, and we're going to read verse 38 as well, with his disciples. And it says, when he, that is Christ, saw the multitude, he was moved with compassion for them, because they were weary and scattered like sheep having no shepherd. Verse 37. Then he said to his disciples, the harvest truly is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Therefore, pray the Lord of harvest to send out laborers into his harvest. I want you to notice something here. Jesus did not say, oh, well, there aren't many people who want to hear the gospel. Oh, everybody is denying the truth. They don't want to know what God's will is. They don't want to hear that I am his son, that I am the savior of mankind. They're just rejecting me left and right. No, what he said, after seeing the multitude scattered about, he had compassion and said this, the harvest is plentiful. There are people who want to hear the truth. But what's needed, Jesus says, the laborers are what are few. He says, therefore, to his disciples, pray what? Pray the Lord of harvest to make your harvest better, to make the crops grow more, to make more people interested in the truth. No, pray the Lord of harvest to send out laborers into his harvest. The question that we need to be asking ourselves as members of the Lord's church is not how many baptisms we've had, not how big is our attendance number, not how many Bible studies I've had this week, but am I being a laborer for the Lord? Am I fulfilling that responsibility that God has put before me? Everyone has their own choice. You can't force people to study the Bible with you, but are you doing your part to make that opportunity, that opening that door for someone to study the gospel? That is what we need to ask ourselves. And that is what our Lord says we need to pray for. More laborers in God's kingdom. And I want to tell you, here at the Ooga Church of Christ, that even if you've been discouraged, maybe this year, maybe this month, maybe this week, you've started to feel discouraged, I'm here to tell you that your labor has not been in vain. You have been working in the Lord's kingdom, and it has yielded fruit. This is Johnny, one of the men that we studied with in the village of Botindom. He was baptized while we were there. And it wasn't just because of my teaching or my father's teaching, but it was because the men of the village, the Christian men, had talked to John and invited him to the Bible study in the Bible classes. It was because we were there at the right time to be able to sit down and study with him. And it's because you were willing to send us and do that work yourself. So this soul that was saved, God adds that to your account. He attributes you with that labor and that effort. Not only him, Pio is a man I mentioned earlier. He was a man who wanted to know and be sure of his salvation, and he was baptized while we were there. And that was because of the work that you were doing. So I hope to leave you in this presentation, not just with information about the work that we've been doing, but about the work that you've been doing. And to show you what the Lord requires of us as Christians, and to tell you how thankful I am for your work in God's kingdom, and remind you that you are working in God's kingdom, and to encourage you to continue in that labor in the Pacific, but also here in your local area. Thank you so much for your attention this morning. We're going to take about 10 minutes, and then we will begin worship in a moment.